They were young, educated, and both virgins on this, their wedding night. And they lived in a time when a conversation about sexual difficulties was plainly impossible. But it is never easy. They had just sat down to supper in a tiny sitting room on the first floor of a Georgian inn. In the next room, visible through the open door, was a four-poster bed, rather narrow, whose bed cover was pure white and stretched startlingly smooth, as though by no human hand. Edward did not mention that he had never stayed in a hotel before, whereas Florence, after many trips as a child with her father, was an old hand. Superficially, they were in fine spirits. Their wedding at St. Mary's, Oxford, had gone well. The service was decorous, the reception jolly, the send-off from school and college friends raucous and uplifting. Her parents had not condescended to his, as they had feared, and his mother had not significantly misbehaved or completely forgotten the purpose of the occasion. The couple had driven away in a small car belonging to Florence's mother and arrived in the early evening at their hotel on the Dorset coast in weather that was not perfect for mid-July or the circumstances, but entirely adequate. It was not raining, but nor was it quite warm enough, according to Florence, to eat outside on the terrace as they had hoped. Edward thought it was, but polite to a fault, he would not think of contradicting her on such an evening. On Chesil Beach is built round a fairly classical proportion. It's has a unity of place, a young couple, sexual virgins, their wedding night. One of the first things I wrote in a notebook when I was planning this novel was not about Edward or Florence, but the tone with which I was going to tell this story. There's no character telling this story, but there's an implied sense of a human being who knows everything and who knows the future, you know, who knows where this decade will end up.
Yes, well, he's retelling a time, and that voice recaptures the innocence of virginity.
I can absolutely understand the situation that's proposed here. You know, that two young people get married and they haven't even thought or certainly not talked about sex, let alone not had it.
One thing that the book is very much about is the way in which people can be prisoners of their ethos, of the time that they live in. The date of events is very important. It's July 1962. It's technically in the 1960s, but it's not really in the 60s in the sense of sexual liberation. That's all going to start about 1963.
But as what we call the 60s is really the 70s, 62 is really the 50s in terms of culture. You know, modesty still exists.
A lot of parents or grandparents would understand that notion that, you know, these two young lovers get together and that's it. You know, it's like it's going to be a rough first night.
They separately worried about the moment sometime soon after dinner when their new maturity would be tested, when they would lie down together on the four-poster bed and reveal themselves fully to one another. For over a year, Edward had been mesmerized by the prospect that on the evening of a given date in July, the most sensitive portion of himself would reside, however briefly, within a naturally formed cavity inside this cheerful, pretty, formidably intelligent woman. How this was to be achieved without absurdity or disappointment troubled him. His specific worry, based on one unfortunate experience, was of overexcitement, of what he had heard someone describe as arriving too soon. The matter was rarely out of his thoughts, but though his fear of failure was great, his eagerness for rapture, for resolution, was far greater. Florence's anxieties were more serious, and there were moments during the journey from Oxford when she thought she was about to draw on all her courage to speak her mind. But what troubled her was unutterable, and she could barely frame it for herself. Where he merely suffered conventional first-night nerves, she experienced a visceral dread, a helpless disgust as palpable as seasickness. For much of the time, through all the months of merry wedding preparation, she managed to ignore this stain on her happiness. But whenever her thoughts turned towards a close embrace, she preferred no other term. Her stomach tightened dryly. She was nauseous at the back of her throat.